Sid Roth here. Welcome to my world, where it's naturally supernatural. How in the world did we get to where we are right now? How did we get here? How did we get to the point where all over America, little boys and little girls are coming home from school, and they're saying with all seriousness, "Mommy, am I a boy or am I a girl?" Well, I want you to know something. We are about ready to have a supernatural outpouring of God's Spirit that we are going to change the destiny of this generation. We're not satisfied the way it is, and my guests are going to show you how. Are you ready to know how?
Yes.
Me too.
Is there a supernatural dimension? A world beyond the one we know? Is there life after death? Do angels exist? Can our dreams contain messages from heaven? Can we tap into ancient secrets of the supernatural? Are healing miracles real? Sid Roth has spent over 35 years researching the strange world of the supernatural. Join Sid for this edition of It's Supernatural.
I hope you are as high in the spirit as we are for this show. I want to welcome our friends at GB America and thank them for partnering with us on this very special live program. I have, as many of you can recognize them, the Benham Brothers here. And I found out before we went on the air which one's the smartest and which one's the handsomest. They both say they are. But if you're not that familiar with them, they have been on CNN, Fox, ABC, Nightline, Good Morning America. They're former professional baseball players and entrepreneurs. You guys look too young for all of this.
Hey, we're 40.
Now, who's the youngest? That one I can ask.
Well, you're going to have to tell us that. I think the wrinkles on his head would make him a little older than me. He's the youngest by 2 minutes. But okay. You know, now you realize in the Bible, the older always serves the younger. See, this is just...
Well, I realize that in the Bible. I don't have that problem because I don't have a brother.
But,
however, you seem like such nice people. How did you cause such a firestorm in the media? I mean, you're such calm. You have a good sense of humor. Well, what is it with you two?
Well, there's a label now. If you stand for life and if you stand for marriage and if you stand for biblical values, then you're an extremist. And one of the things that happened with my brother and I, you know, you said we were entrepreneurs. When we got out of professional baseball, we moved to the Charlotte area and built a business. I mean, we're American history majors, so we didn't study business. We had no idea we were entrepreneurs. We simply applied biblical principles in the marketplace. And a few years later, we had 100 offices across 35 states. That attracted some networks. TLC made us our first offer. HGTV made us offers. I mean, it was crazy. These reality television show networks were asking us, we want you guys on
TV. But you guys are perfectly suited for this. I can see it. You're made to do this. So how come they're so meshuggah? That's a Hebrew word. It means crazy. How come they're so meshuggah not to have you? What happened? Why was there such an uproar?
Well, you know, what's interesting is that when HGTV reached out to us, there were several other networks that wanted us as well. And HG realized as they began to look at the internet that my brother and I were pretty vocal about a few things, specifically that marriage is between a man and a woman, and that life begins at conception. And I remember them calling us and saying, you know, hey, can we talk about these views that you have? And we discussed it with them. And you know what? They were great with it. They said, hey, we realize that you guys don't hate anybody. You're great people. You're entrepreneurs. You've been serving folks selling homes in the Charlotte area and around the country for a decade. And we're excited to have you on the show. But the problem was, is that when they began to air commercials announcing our show, Well, a few activist groups got a hold of that and reached out to HGTV and said, hey, do you realize who these guys are? They hate women, they hate gays, they hate Muslims, and none of that stuff is true. And they really began to put pressure.
You know what's amazing to me? A small group of people have so much clout. These activists, they don't realize it, but they're activists for the enemy. Where are God's activists? I think God is entitled to some real activists. But you guys, when you turned it down, you gave up millions. You realize that?
Well, it's it.
Your parents can't be Jewish.
Well, we do realize it. We never got to cash the big check.
Yeah.
You know, we like to say it's fun to follow Jesus until you find out where he's going. He's going to a cross, and he bids us to pick it up and follow him. And we found ourselves in that situation. And truly, around the world is where the true persecution is taking place. Here in America, it's just simply pressure.
Right.
But the pressure will turn to persecution if we don't stand and speak. And Jesus, in his own words in Matthew 5:11, said, blessed are you when you are persecuted and falsely accused. He says, blessed are you. Rejoice and be glad, because they treated the prophets before you the same way. And so what we have to do as Christians is understand it is it's a blessing, and we should rejoice in the fact when we are falsely accused. Unfortunately, today, many in the Christian church believe, man, if there's false accusations, if someone calls me a bigot, well, then I just don't want to touch the issues. And the thing is that's a ploy of Satan. He knows that if he can get you to be labeled, you'll just run from the battle. And we knew we can't do that.
Can I piggyback on that?
Please.
But your next question is probably going to be better than what I'm going to piggyback with. But when
it is.
You know, David and I never made it to the big leagues. We both ended our baseball career in AA. And yet when you read that verse that David talked about, blessed are you when people persecute you and falsely accuse you and say all things about you because of my name, Jesus says. That's essentially like that when those labels start flying your way, it's like Jesus is saying, hey, I'm bringing you up to the big leagues now. Let's go. You're coming up to the big leagues with me, because now we get a chance to be labeled just as Jesus was labeled, and all of it was false, but we do it for his glory.
Well, you know, those same verses say another thing, and I took it literally. When you're persecuted, it says jump for joy. And you know, if you literally jump in the air for joy, by the time you come down on the ground, you're going to have joy. Now, we went out on the streets of Charlotte, North Carolina, to ask people, would you give up millions of dollars? Let's see what we found out.
No, I would not go on TV for $1 million to compromise all my beliefs, no.
If you offered me $1 million to go on public TV and say something that wasn't my own opinion, then I wouldn't do it. No.
If I had $1 million to compromise everything I believe in on TV, I would not do that at all. I don't understand. Recently, I don't know if you saw the show, but there was this woman on there, and she was interacting with someone of color, and then she said, you should go back to the field and pick cotton, and you're nappy-headed, this. And it doesn't matter how much money you should pay somebody, you shouldn't be able to compromise, you know, your own values, or just say rude things about other people or other groups that you know nothing about.
There's not enough money to make me do that, because I have to sleep at night.
I would not take $1 million to go publicly across the country on camera to compromise what I believe in, because that's not being true to myself, and I can't live with that.
No, I would not.
No.
I don't think so.
I like the thought of integrity and sticking with what you believe, but I think you need to be very thoughtful about your beliefs. I think beliefs are more at a principle level and not a tactical level. And so you need to be true to them. Then again, you need to compromise sometimes, but you don't compromise on your basic important beliefs.
If you gave me $1 million to go on TV and compromise everything I believe in, would I go on television? No.
When we come back, I am going to ask the Benham Brothers how they got the way they are. There's courage I see there. They are courageous. I want to know how they got that way. Well, I'll help you out a little bit. They have a father who was a minister, and he just happens to move his office next to a big abortion clinic, right next to it. It's the abortion clinic that Jane Roe from Roe versus Wade is running. And wait till you find out about the chutzpah, another Hebrew word. The nerve that their dad had. Be right back.
We'll be right back to It's Supernatural.
If you love watching our It's Supernatural TV program, you can now watch hundreds of archive programs online, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, on your computer, your smartphone, your iPad, or your favorite tablet. In addition to archive programs, you'll be able to also watch special ministry and mentoring sessions taped at our It's Supernatural Media and Mentoring Center in Charlotte, North Carolina, with the best teachers in the various gifts of the Holy Spirit. You will also be able to enter into the presence of God through anointed worship and special soaking prayer sessions. Just log on to sidroth.org/ISN.
ISN will be the vehicle to equip you to being normal, normal as defined by the Bible. You will be taught and receive impartation to walk in the supernatural of God like never before.
That's sidroth.org/ISN.
We now return to It's Supernatural.
Okay, before I get to the famous Jane Roe of Roe versus Wade, we went out on the streets of Charlotte again to find out what people thought about murdering innocent babies in the womb. It's really child sacrifice. If you read the Old Covenant, that's what they used to do. They used to sacrifice children. But we use the squeaky clean word, abortion, not murdering babies in the womb. But let's see what the people in Charlotte had to say on the streets. Ryan Bross is interviewing.
Do I believe abortion is wrong? Those decisions should be made up to the individual person. The government should have no right to tell you what you can and cannot do.
A woman needs to have the right to choose if she wants to keep the baby or not.
I am not in favor of abortion, but I do think it's a more complicated issue than just a black and white issue.
I do not believe abortion. I believe abortion is wrong.
Do I believe that abortion is wrong? No, I do not. There are so many cases where women are abused by either family members or strangers or maybe people that they know. And so the question really should be, is abuse of women wrong? Yeah, it's completely wrong. And so if they're in that situation and they have a child out of that, they should be able to do what they want with their own bodies.
I don't believe abortion is a call that I need to make.
No, I don't believe abortion is wrong.
No, I do not, because half the kids out here today are born into a lifestyle which they are not able to get everything they should be able to get in America, as if they're raised by their grandparents because their parents aren't there. They're too young, they're still in school, they're out on the streets doing drugs, this and that. So if they're not ready to have a kid, I believe it's a good decision to either get an abortion or put them for adoption.
I do think that abortion is wrong.
Abortion is wrong, yes. I think abortion is wrong because in the Bible it says, thou shalt not kill, so we are not supposed to kill. No matter what it is, you have to maintain it because you don't know what the future baby is going to be. So I think it's wrong.
David and Jason have an amazing father. I just met him for the first time. And I'll tell you what, I have an idea your dad is your hero.
Yeah.
I mean, at one point, he was like everyone else. He was an alcoholic in trouble. And another point, God reveals his presence. He becomes gloriously a believer in the Messiah. And he becomes a pastor, and he has so much of this chutzpah I was talking about. He literally moves his office right next door to an abortion clinic of the famous Jane Roe from Roe versus Wade. And how long did it take for him to lead Jane Roe to the Lord?
It was just a couple of years. And as a matter of fact, he was there, and my dad's secretary, her name was Rhonda, would have her daughters bring over cookies to the abortion clinic to Miss Norma while she was there. And what we didn't know at the time, but Dad had invited Miss Norma over to our house, and she brought her lesbian partner, Miss Connie. And it was just a couple of years later, Miss Norma prayed to receive Jesus. Dad baptized her, and that's when, back in the day, when Nightline and Ted Koppel and all of these networks were there. And it was what was really cool is that nobody really knew is that then Miss Connie gave her heart to Jesus Christ. And we didn't, Dad goes, she gave her heart right there. And Dad goes, boys, go to Walmart and get a blow up swimming pool. We're going to baptize her right now. Well, you know.
You Benhams don't mess around.
But he didn't stop there. 2 weeks later, he told us to get a U-Haul truck, and we did. And we drove it to Miss Norma and Connie's house, and we moved Miss Norma out. And God delivered her from that lifestyle. That's exactly right. So we've seen the power of the Holy Spirit. We've actually watched it. Oftentimes, you know, as Jason and I speak, and as especially with a lot of different Christians, we want to see abortion come to an end. But if we just fight to end abortion, we stop short. We miss the goal. We seek to advance the kingdom of heaven on earth through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's what we watched in that life, and that's what will ultimately overcome abortion.
Now, you two tell me that this generation desperately needs the courage of Daniel. Comment on that.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you just look at what was happening in Babylon at the time, and Daniel wasn't much older than, what, 15, 16, 17 years old at the time. And we get a chance to see a young man who had conviction that transformed his heart, that manifested itself in commitments that transformed his lifestyle. And ultimately, those flowed through into courage that transformed his world. We need that right now, as I think that anybody that doesn't have their head buried in the sand can see that it's getting darker in America right now, and now's the time to stand. This is the greatest time ever to be alive. What's really cool about Daniel's life is when the cultural winds began to shift and no longer favored his convictions. Because throughout his life, as you read in the book of Daniel, you see that the culture did favor his convictions at time, and he was elevated to a position of influence. But in Daniel chapter 6, you see those winds of change. When that Babylonian kingdom became the Persian kingdom, and now they targeted his faith, what did Daniel do? And you know what? He stood with courage. And that's exactly what we're seeing in America today. The cultural winds are shifting to actually target the Christian faith. And we have a choice. Are we going to stand with courage, or are we going to tuck tail and run like cowards?
Well, speaking of courage, Jason, you were in professional baseball, and they said, we want you to speak for 5,000 fans. Yeah. Now, did they give you a subject? Tell me briefly what
happened. You know, it was student night. This was my third year in professional baseball. I was in high A with the Frederick Keys, which was the Baltimore Orioles affiliate. And there's a chapter in our book called Let It Be Known. And what we're saying by that is just enter the conversation. In the culture, we're especially asking pastors, look, just talk about the issues today. Just use your voice and let it be known. And I remember it was student night there in Frederick. 5,000 students and all their parents came, and they told me, they said, hey, Jason, we want you for 60 seconds to address the crowd and encourage these kids to read books. And I walked up to the clubhouse. I had no idea what I was going to say, and I came down, I grabbed the microphone, and I belted out the theme song from Phantom of the Opera. Just kidding. I want to make sure that you didn't really follow me on that one. But you're there. Okay. Well, I remember grabbing the microphone, and in that moment, the Holy Spirit just gave me something to say, because I felt as though in that moment, I needed to let it be known who was my God and my King. And I said, you know, the two greatest
things. But wait a second. There's a big risk.
You're exactly right.
Didn't that cross your mind?
It did.
Didn't it cross your mind you might lose your career?
I'm not saying I wasn't scared.
Okay.
I was a little nervous, but my dad taught me, don't let the butterflies in your stomach stop you from doing what's right. Make them fly in formation. So just before I walked up there, I grabbed that microphone, and I said, you know, the two greatest things in life are the people you meet and the books you read. The greatest book I've ever read is the Bible, and the greatest man that I've ever met is Jesus Christ. He changed my life, and he'll change yours too if you'll read his book. And that was it. The crowd erupted.
Good.
They did.
All right, and I'll tell you what, and then you two were off to the races.
That's exactly right.
We went out on the streets of Charlotte to find out if people feel we're losing our freedom of speech. I mean, I think it is horrific that men and women of God, if they stand up for what the Bible says in America, they could lose their tax deductibility. Well, guess what? We're about ready not to have tax deductibility, so it doesn't matter. We're about ready to have men and women that call themselves ministers be just like Paul. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Let's go to the streets of Charlotte and find out what people think about freedom of speech.
I don't believe Americans are losing their freedom of speech. I honestly don't believe that many Americans have really had a chance to voice their freedom of speech. Without some kind of retribution.
I believe Americans are losing their freedom of speech a little bit because people get too offended too easily about things.
Well, I don't know. I never thought of that. I don't see any reason, you know, I don't see any problems with people saying what they believe.
Do I believe that America's freedom of speech is being eliminated? No, I don't think so.
Absolutely. I do think that Americans are starting to lose their freedom of speech. Yes. We're having to censor everything that we believe in. We're having to censor ourselves. I feel like one side of things are allowed to state their opinion, but others are having to hold back, and it's not fair.
Okay, you guys say that darkness is not the problem. What do you mean?
Have you ever gone to bed at night?
And
told your wife, hey, hon, turn the darkness on.
Never.
No, what do you say? Turn the light off, right?
Yeah.
The only way darkness prevails is when light is turned off, because that's the nature of light. So the problem today is not the presence of darkness. The problem is the absence of light. And so Christ is telling us today in this hour, the Holy Spirit is breathing through us, shine the light of the gospel. Don't be afraid. And here's what's interesting about light. Light not only exposes your good deeds, Matthew 5:16, let your light so shine before the world that they may see your good works, that they may glorify your Father in heaven. And we see that in Daniel's life, as we wrote in our book. But you know what light also does? John chapter 3, it exposes the world's evil deeds. So it exposes good deeds and it exposes evil deeds. And when it exposes evil deeds...
You're going to let me interrupt you?
Not yet. When it exposes evil deeds...
You guys are as bad as me.
It says the world will hate you. It says the darkness hated the light because it exposes that its deeds were evil. So we don't have to worry about whether it shines on our good deeds or shines on the world's evil deeds. We just shine the light.
And I want to piggyback on that, because today we have in Christianity the wrong idea of light. See, we grew up singing the song, "This Little Light of Mine, I'm going to let it shine." And we have the imagery of a candle. But when a wind comes along and blows on a candle, what happens? The light goes out. We need to replace that imagery with burning embers, like in a fire pit. And what happens when a wind comes along and blows on those? The same wind that extinguished the candle's light actually ignited the light of a coal. So the question today is, are you going to be a candle or a coal? Jeremiah said, your word is like a fire pent up in my bones. It's shut up in my bones. I'm weary of holding it in. We're encouraging young kids, you go after God with everything that you can. You open up His Word, and that will become a fire. And that's why when HGTV, don't you interrupt me.
I got something to say.
That's why when HGTV fired us, and then the cultural winds began to blow, and the devil was trying to extinguish our light, that very act was actually igniting something that was inside of us.
Which is exactly what young Daniel was doing in Babylon. And we write about in our book, the prophet that he was reading, the prophet that actually prophesied they were going into Babylon, and while they were in Babylon, was Jeremiah. And so we know that the same words that we were reading about the Word of God being a fire inside of our bones is exactly the words that young Daniel was reading. And that's why we know that this message of Daniel's life is relevant for today just as much as it was for him.
And you were talking about young Jeremiah. Well, Jeremiah says this. God was speaking to him. He said, before you were conceived in your mother's womb, I knew you and I called you. I appointed you. So why? How do we have the right to extinguish someone that God has appointed, God has called? Let's see what the people of Charlotte on the street had to say.
That's kind of tough. I believe everyone has a right to do their own thing and believe what they want to believe and, you know, how they want to live their lives.
No. I don't think that it's wrong.
Absolutely not.
I believe it is as wrong as any other sin that we all commit.
No, I do not.
No, I feel like people should be able to live their life the way they want to, and other people shouldn't judge them for it.
I don't believe homosexuality is wrong. I believe it's a personal opinion.
No, I believe everyone should have the room to be and whoever they are, they need to be.
Most people are homophobic and most homosexuals are treated differently. I don't believe it's wrong, but I believe we should treat them as we treat each other.
It's not something that falls in line with my beliefs, but I don't think it's something that needs to be forced upon a bunch of people.
I do not believe homosexuality is wrong. I believe that if you love somebody, who's other people to tell you who you can and cannot love?
I believe homosexuality is wrong.
So what do you guys say? Is homosexuality wrong?
Homosexuality is a sin just like any other sin. And here's what's interesting.
Is it worse than others?
It's not worse than any other sin, but here's what's interesting is that what we're finding in America is that we are now taking a sin and institutionalizing, and we've gone from acceptance to appreciation to celebration and now forced participation. That's what we're seeing with this. You don't see thieves writing curriculum demanding that your kindergartner accept it and begin to act like a thief. But this is what we're seeing with the homosexual agenda, and people call us bigots and haters for saying that. It's the truth, and we speak it in love, and here's a story that will let you know that we're speaking this in love is because Jason and I, we were in Tampa, Florida, and we had just been all over television with all this stuff that happened with HGTV, and we sell a lot of different houses, and we were there actually conducting business, and this homosexual man comes up to me, and he was showing us around the office, and he said, "Hey, I just want you and your brother to know that I'm a homosexual." And I put my hand on his back and I said, "Well, thank you for telling me that. I think there's probably a reason why you told me that." And he began to just tell me his life story. And I knew that God wanted me to simply open the Word of God and just read it very softly and lovingly to him. And I opened the Word of God to 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 9 through 11, which is the passage you're not supposed to read in America anymore. And if we lose our freedom of speech, we won't be able to read that. Well, we will, but we're just going to suffer for it. Put my hand on his back and I said, "Will you listen to the Word of God, what the Lord says?" And I went through where it says, do you know that homosexuals, adulterers, fornicators, thieves, drunkards will not inherit the kingdom of God? And I could see his chin start to quiver, but I didn't stop there. I kept reading and he said, "But such were some of you. You were washed. You were sanctified. You were cleansed in the blood of Jesus Christ." And that guy, the tears just start flowing down his face. And I'm watching this, standing on the outside, watching the Holy Spirit convict him through the Word of God. I wasn't doing anything creative or trying to use the Word to get him saved. And all of a sudden, I just simply asked, "Are you ready to pray and surrender your life to Christ?" And he said, "Yes, I am." It was unbelievable.
I have to ask you two a very important question. And I know you guys are transparent. I know you guys have integrity. I know you guys are honest. You've demonstrated that to the world. Do you love someone if you find out that they are a lesbian or a homosexual? I mean, really and truly, do you?
Yes. And we're required to love all people. But we also know that love involves compassion with standards. If you remove standards, then we become like the verse in Proverbs that says, if you spare the rod, you hate your child, which means you can have compassion for your kid. But if you don't erect standards, you know, God's boundaries bring God's blessings. But if we remove his boundaries, those boundaries are replaced with burdens. The blessings are replaced with burdens. And so if we don't bring compassion plus standards, then that's not love. That's actually hate. And one of the things we did is when a lot of these groups targeted us while we were with HGTV, we sent invitations into our home for dinner. We actually sent edible arrangements out to the folks. I mean, and we said, "Will you please come to our home?" Jason actually had a gay couple into his home and had dinner with them. And you know, listen, when we have a chance to minister to a homosexual or to anyone, to a transgender or anyone now with the hot button sin issues in culture, we don't change the way that we minister to someone that's caught in pornography or an adulterer or a thief or a liar or a gossip, which we've been, and God has changed us. And so we bring the hope of Jesus Christ because we love him enough to tell him the truth. And I thank God that someone loved us enough to tell us the truth when we were caught in sin.
Well, let me tell you something. I recently developed a friendship with a woman who told me, and she was proud of it, that she's a lesbian. She comes from a Christian family. She knows what the Bible has to say. And this is what I said to her, and I meant it before God. "I will love you If you never change, you stay a lesbian the rest of your life, I will love you. But you are missing out on the full love of God, which is better than any human love you've ever had in your life. There is a pure love that transcends anything you've ever experienced previously. And I'm going to keep talking about that because the truth of the matter is that you cannot enjoy the goodness of God, which there's nothing this world has to offer compared to the goodness of God. And so you know what? I'm going to start reading the Bible. Well, she came back the next week and said, I'm reading the Bible. It was a New Age Bible. And I said, let's get you another Bible. Yeah. But when we come back, and I am absolutely shocked over this, there is a book dedicated to Satan that much of the press, and you'll be amazed at the politicians that quote directly from this book. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back to It's Supernatural.
The Benham Brothers were real estate tycoons that were offered their own reality TV program on HGTV. But because they stood on their moral convictions concerning what is holy and what is sin, HGTV canceled their contract. God rewarded the Benham Brothers for their faithfulness by giving them a bigger platform than they would have had with their own TV program. They continue to appear on the most watched secular news programs. They're speaking in large venues across America, sharing the gospel and continuing to promote biblical morality. Now they want to share how you can obtain supernatural courage to be a world changer. Call now and get David and Jason Benham's Daniel Anointing Package, which includes their book, Living Among Lions, How to Thrive Like Daniel in Today's Babylon, and their three-part audio CD teaching, How to Be a World Changer, plus Dr. Jen Clark's audio CD, Answering Questions in a Modern-Day Babylon. Yours for a donation of $35. Shipping and handling is included. Ask for offer number 9406. In the Benham Brothers' powerful must-read book, Living Among Lions, they passionately share their own story of taking a stand for righteousness, even though it appeared to rob them of great notoriety and prosperity through having their own TV reality program on HGTV. But what the enemy meant to harm, God used to prosper them. In the book, they draw upon the Jewish Old Testament prophet Daniel.
Daniel stood up for God against certain persecution. The Benham Brothers stood up for God against certain persecution. Guess what? Daniel was elevated to number two in the kingdom. Guess what? The Benham Brothers are a household word and doing just fine. If God is for you, who can be against you? The same thing that happened to Daniel, the same thing that happened to the Benham Brothers is going to happen for you if you'll put God first. What are you going to do?
You'll also receive the Benham Brothers' exclusive three-part audio CD teaching series, How to Be a World Changer.
On these three CDs, there is an impartation of supernatural courage, special prayers at the end, but even as they share, this courage is going to go right out of the CD into you. It's called the Daniel Anointing. And we are in a time that either Christians will have courage or this is what's going to happen. We're going to lose our country. We're going to lose our children. We're going to lose our families. We're going to flat lose everything. Well, I have faith that God is going to change America. There's going to be a great move of God's Spirit, but God is looking for people with a Daniel anointing. What are you going to tell your children when they come in from elementary school and say, Mom, Dad, am I a male or a female? Am I a boy or a girl? You've got to decide which you're going to do. Are you going to have good answers for good questions? Or are you going to be just roll over and play dead? I mean, you choose.
You will also receive Dr. Jen Clark's exclusive audio CD, Answering Questions in a Modern Day Babylon.
I'm so excited about Dr. Jen Clark because she put together the latest findings in science. This is a woman that has a PhD, Dr. Clark. She has degrees in psychology and in theology, and she's a specialist in the brain. Latest science says what the Bible says. Now, I have faith for all the sexual deviancy that is being taught as normal to turn around. But you can't roll over and play dead. Now you choose. What do you want for your family? What do you want for your country? Some of the things that Dr. Jen Clark said, I've never even pondered. Like, for instance, she talks about the difference between love and lust, marriage biblically, living together without being married. Does morality change because the times have changed? And these are things that honest people are going to be asking you.
With all the pressure by the unbelieving world to be silent, to be politically correct, you need this one-of-a-kind Daniel anointing package for such a time as this.
You need the answers. I can't impress upon you more with what is going on in society and how quickly it's lowering the bar. Someone, somewhere has to stand up. Say, that's me, Sid. I want to stand up. I want the Daniel anointing.
Don't miss out on getting David and Jason Benham's Daniel Anointing Package, which includes their book, Living Among the Lions, How to Thrive Like Daniel in Today's Babylon, plus their three-part audio CD teaching, How to Be a World Changer, plus Dr. Jen Clark's audio CD, Answering Questions in a Modern-Day Babylon. Yours for a donation of $35. Shipping and handling is included. Ask for offer number 9406. Call or you can send your check to Sid Roth. It's Supernatural. P.O. Box 39222, Charlotte, North Carolina. Carolina 28278. Please specify offer number 9406 or log on to sidroth.org. Call or write today.
We now return to It's Supernatural.
All right, again, we went out in the streets of Charlotte and we said, what one word would you use? I want you to think about this too. What one word would you use to describe our nation? Let's see.
In one word, describe our nation? Messed up.
Messed up. It's two words.
Okay. Let me say, messed up is two words. I'm describing our nation in a single word. I would say confused.
Unique.
Under stress. Yeah. Chaotic.
Conflicted. Troubled.
We're going through change as a nation. I think that's the best way to describe it. And that's good in a lot of ways because change is what gets us where we need to be. It's just painful.
Yeah, no, Benhams. I have a problem with that. And I'm going to tell you why. I have seen what is about ready to happen to our nation. And I have seen this through the eyes of faith, not through the eyes of what is actually going on. And every fiber of my being says, my word to describe America is light. Yeah. The light of God, the power of God, the spirit of God. And you know what? God liked that so much, he just got a couple of people healed. There are people, if you have a back pain, listen to me now, you stand up and bend over, and the pain is gone in Jesus' name. You have something wrong with your wrist or your arm, just start moving it. You'll see that that pain is gone. Now, I really was upset when I read about a man and a book. The book is called Rules for Radicals, written by Saul Alinsky. And tell me about why this is, well, it's being quoted, and this is a book dedicated to the devil. That's right. Why are politicians, why are news media quoting this verbatim?
Well, I'll tell you what, when Jason and I were in the middle of this whole situation and we just found this narrative that was developed against us that was so false and so wrong, and then the media and politicians and even leaders in the business world began to speak, and it seemed like they were following a plan, lock, stock, and barrel, every one of them. And I was like, man, this is fishy. This doesn't add up. And so I found out about this book called Rules for Radicals. I ordered it online. I was blown away when I opened up the acknowledgments right there, the dedication dedicated to Lucifer. I flipped it over on the back. The Chicago Sun-Times gave an endorsement and said, this book has influenced politicians like Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama that have been following the rules of this book. And I'm paraphrasing their endorsement there. So I start reading through the book. Listen to a couple of the rules. This is written in the 1960s by Saul Alinsky, and this is exactly what we see happening in America. Here are rules for radicals. If you want to engage and overturn America for what they call change, here's what you do. Ridicule is man's most potent weapon. There is no defense. It's irrational, infuriating, and works as a key pressure point to force the enemy into concessions. Here's another one. If you push a negative hard enough, it will push through and become a positive. Here's another one. Pick the target, freeze it, personalize it, and polarize it. Cut off the support network and isolate the target from sympathy. Go after people and not institutions. People hurt faster than institutions. And we watched that. We got picked right off, isolated. And what they tried to do was isolate Jason and me by creating a narrative that we hate gays and we hate women and all these things which are patently false, and create that narrative and then isolate us away from ministries. We actually had ministries, two significantly sized ministries in the middle of this whole HGTV situation call us and say, guys, we have to create distance from you because we don't want to get thrust into this media firestorm.
But here's what's interesting about that. If you're expecting a battle, you'll fully be ready to engage in it. So when it came our way, we could see what was happening. God allowed us to fully engage in that battle and pull out the sword of the Spirit and just start chopping things in the air.
Now, one of the things that you teach is the devil's top strategy is to get you to compromise. Comment.
Absolutely. Devil wants you to compromise. You know, if you can be bought, there will always be a buyer. Judas teaches us this. And so the devil knows exactly that whatever God has placed in your hand, even that good thing, that thing, if you take your focus off of the person of God who gave you that thing and you put it onto that promise or that platform or that purpose or whatever it is that God has given to you, that's the very thing that's going to enslave you. And you look like you want to interrupt
me. I do want to say
something
real quick.
You know what? I'm going to grant you permission
okay.
this one time.
What we write in our book, and we write this in one of the early chapters, we say we want to be like Daniel, who was a chocolate chip in the cookie dough of culture. Here's what I mean. When we make, or when he makes chocolate chip cookie dough,
he would never do that.
Of course not. When you make the dough, you take the butter and the salt and the sugar and the flour and all those things and you blend them together. And now if you take a scoop of that, you don't know if you're tasting salt, butter, or whatever. It all just blends together and loses its form. But when you pour in the chocolate chips, you know when you've been into a chocolate chips. You know, and the thing is that chocolate chips keep their distinct form. They mix into the batch, but they never blend in, even when put into the oven.
And David Waistline would tell you he's eaten one too many.
Whatever. But here's the key, is that...
If he's eaten one too many, how many have I... No.
but the compromise that's in the church, Satan wants us to compromise. Just blend into the dough, and no one can even tell a distinct
form. Wait a second.
Form.
The whole church system today, the most popular churches, are seeker-sensitive. Yeah. When are we going to have a God-sensitive church?
Hell yeah.
That's what the world is crying for, and the young people that are about ready to come to the Lord with this great move of God's Spirit, amen, they're not going to be satisfied for seeker-sensitive. If they want seeker sensitive, they can go to a rock concert. That's seeker sensitive.
And we say that's when churchianity has replaced Christianity. When boot camp has been replaced with a bounce house. And you see, if the Marines recruited people to the Marines and they on their commercials, they put that you're getting together, you're having a great time, you're fellowshipping, you're swimming in pools and drinking beer and all this kind of stuff that you see on beer commercials. If the Marines recruited that way, the first time that the person goes and they get put in the middle of Baghdad, Iraq, and the first bullet that flies past their head, what are they going to do? They're going to run from the battlefield. Because they were recruited the wrong way. You see, God is teaching us to stand strong right where we are, and that churches are the ones who equip us for battle. We've lost that. We've turned into a bounce house. And you know what? Here's another interesting thing, Sid, is that when our culture worships entertainment, they're going to seek an entertainer to lead it. And we see that happening right now.
Okay. Someone's just been healed. You have arthritic type pain in your fingers. You bend your fingers. It's gone in Jesus' name. Well, here we are right in a city, Charlotte, North Carolina, that is infamous. Sports teams are refusing to have their big championship games. Many conventions are saying, I don't want to go to Charlotte, because they have a controversial bill. It's called the bathroom bill. And they want to change bathrooms. They want to let people choose which bathrooms they want to go to when we come back. I want to discuss this. Be right back.
We'll be right back to It's Supernatural.
Call now and get Sid Roth's The Healing Scripture Package, which includes his brand new The Healing Scriptures book and his interactive Healing Scriptures Soaking audio CD, plus his anointed audio CD teaching on 10 keys to receiving miracles and healing. Get one for a donation of $25, offer number 1862, or get two for $45 and give one away, offer number 9319. Shipping and handling is included. Included is The Healing Scriptures book, filled with the most powerful healing scriptures from the Bible that Sid has personally handpicked and personalized for you to pray over your life. Includes a question and answer section where Sid answers the most asked questions on the subject of healing and miracles. Plus, it includes healing testimonies submitted by real people to our ministry to encourage and uplift you. In addition, you receive the Healing Scriptures audio CD. Sid shares how to use this interactive CD in the introduction. Sid reads the personalized scriptures right from the Healing Scriptures book for you to follow, accompanied by the anointed Israeli music of violinist LaDonna Taylor. Plus, you receive Sid Roth's anointed audio CD teaching, 10 Keys to Receiving Miracles and Healing, recorded live by Sid Roth as he coaches you on how to receive your own healing and how to minister healing to others. Don't miss out on getting Sid Roth's The Healing Scripture Package, which includes his brand new The Healing Scriptures book and his interactive Healing Scriptures Soaking audio CD, plus his anointed audio CD teaching on 10 Keys to Receiving Miracles and Healing. Get one for a donation of $25. Offer number 1862, or get two for $45 and give one away. Offer number 9319. Shipping and handling is included. Call or you can send your check to Sid Roth. It's Supernatural. P.O. Box 39222, Charlotte, North Carolina 28278. Please specify offer number 1862 for one, or offer number 9319 for two, or log on to SidRoth.org. Call or write today.
We now return to It's Supernatural.
Wow, this is going fast. I want to thank GB America for partnering with us with this special live program. And our next live event is going to be on July 21st. I can't wait for it. Our guests are three powerhouses in the supernatural: Joan Hunter, Clarice Fluitt, and Joan Giesen. Now, many of you don't know some of these people. I do. You know what Joan is called? The wheelchair woman. She goes to a Benny Hinn meeting, she represents them, and gets so many people out of wheelchairs, and all three of these women move in the miraculous, and I'm gonna turn them loose. And I'm waiting for those creative miracles to start happening. But then the program is continued on the ISN network. It's Supernatural Network. And for those that don't have it, you can get it on any computer. You can get it on any smartphone. There is no charge. All you do is go to the App Store and type in my name, Sid, S-I-D, Roth, R-O-T-H. You'll see a nice orange app that'll come up. It's called It's Supernatural Television Network. Get that app and you'll be able to see the rest of the show. But guess what? I have a PhD that's a specialist in the brain that tells me the latest science, it's conclusive, Homosexuality is not an accident of birth. It is a learned experience. And science now says, even through science, the brain, it's called plasticity. It's like plastic. You can change it. They never thought that before, but now they know. And people don't have to put up with any sin of society that interrupts them from having a free flow of the love of God. And so I'm going to have Dr. Jen Clark, so be sure to have ready the ISN app, Sid Roth, It's Supernatural Network. Have it ready. And now, Benham Brothers, the human rights campaign, you went to a meeting, Human Rights of Charlotte, what did you find out?
Well, we had heard in 2007 that the Human Rights Campaign, which truly, if you see what's happening around America in city councils, the Human Rights Campaign nationally is behind all of these bathroom bills. And the goal of these bathroom bills is to strip the rights of Americans. And the Human Rights Campaign in 2007 came to Charlotte. They had a dinner, 1,500 people. I wanted to show up, so I just bought a ticket. And I sat there and listened as they had a comedian they brought in from Hollywood, and he stood to the platform and began to entertain folks. And then the president of the organization stood and said, he declared, "We will take this city, we will take this state, we will take this nation. And all of you right-wing bigots that think you can stand against our agenda," then actually he didn't even use the word agenda, "all of you right-wing bigots that think you can stand against us, we've already got you. You're laughing at our humor on primetime television in your living rooms every night. And I'll tell you what."
And he could have added, "We have your children. We have your children in elementary school, in high school, and in college. And we have the entertainment industry. We have most of the media. And just give us enough time, we'll get you." Is that in effect what they were saying?
That's exactly what they were saying. And now let's fast forward 2015. The city of Charlotte put together a proposal for a radical bathroom ordinance. It was a mandate on private businesses. It was forcing, it was opening up our bathrooms to any self-identifying person that would happen to, you were a male and you self-identified as a female, you could go into the bathroom, locker room, shower, whatever. The thing is that they never truly defined self-identification with sexual orientation and gender identity. So sexual orientation is who you go to bed as. Who you go to bed with. Gender identity is who you go to bed as, and that's fluid. It can change in any day. So this opens the door for sexual predators. It's not the transgender community we were concerned about. So when my dad stood there, and the first question he asked to the city attorney in Charlotte and said, "Who was behind this? Who did the council commission you to receive counsel to put this ordinance together?" And he said, "The Human Rights Campaign." And all of it came together for me, 2007 to 2015, 8 years, while many in the Christian community sat silent and sat quietly by, we watched the Human Rights Campaign now bring this radical bathroom ordinance to Charlotte, and all hell has broken loose ever since this.
All right, we went out on the streets of Charlotte. We asked their opinion on this transgender bathroom bill. Let's find out what they said.
No. Because just from growing up in my own life, you know, everyone's always had their own bathroom. And I believe everyone should have their own bathroom. Males should have their own bathrooms. Females should have their own bathrooms. And if there were to be a neutral bathroom, there should be a third option for a neutral specific bathroom.
I try to put myself into the shoes of people that are less fortunate or that have issues. And so as I try to put myself in the shoes of folks that don't identify with a quote unquote normal gender, I can see their point of view. I think the facts say there's no real issue in doing that, so you might as well help the people that are less fortunate.
Let me ask you this. If you had a girl that's 5 years old and a man comes into the bathroom, the women's bathroom, to identify because he identifies as a woman and he's in there with your daughter, are you okay with that?
Yes, I'll be okay with that.
I think they should just create a third bathroom for those who have identity issues, who can't decide, you know, they're a man who feels they're a woman or a woman feels they're a man. This should be a third bathroom so that they can use it, feel comfortable.
Yes, I think it's okay.
because I think everybody, you know, is an individual and they have their rights to do what they want to do. And if they believe there is certain sexuality, then there shouldn't be anything wrong with that.
I believe that depending on the situation, it should be fine. People should be comfortable being able to go to the bathroom. So obviously it's going to be different whether we're talking about an elementary school or a public mall.
I think public bathrooms being gender neutral are, there are probably some variances on particular ones, but overall, yes, I think gender neutral is fine.
Let me ask you this. If you had a girl and a man comes into the bathroom, the women's bathroom, because he identifies as a woman, and he's in there with your daughter, are you okay with that?
I might ask her to wait until the man came out or vice versa. Okay.
I believe in so many senses they are now already. That's a tough one. I'm really not quite sure what to say on that one because it is, I know it's such a big issue. It's a privacy issue, but it's a safety issue as well. So as long as they're safe and there's privacy, I don't have any issue with it.
Well, if I had a daughter, I wouldn't want a man walking in the bathroom to use the bathroom right along with her. And that kind of contradicts what I was saying, how we should treat everybody equally, but at the same time, that is kind of pushing the line in my state.
I do not think it's okay for public bathrooms to be gender neutral.
Do I believe it's okay for public bathrooms to be gender neutral? No. I mean, it doesn't. No one would know if someone was walking in the bathroom that was transgender. So no, I don't think they should be. They should. Everyone should be able to use the bathroom.
If you had a girl, and a man comes into the bathroom, the women's bathroom, because he identifies as a woman, and he's in there with your daughter, are you okay with that?
I'd go in with her.
It have to be gender, because if we combine the two, it's like we are encouraging people to go in for what they want to, and I don't think it's going to help us. So it have to be a gender. Everybody have to go to his or where he or she belongs, yes.
So Jason, what do we do?
Well, obviously you see how dark the world is getting, and that's why we wrote this book, Living Among Lions, How to Thrive Like Daniel in Today's Babylon. And what we see in Daniel's life is that he first was willing to serve God, whatever the cost. That's what he was willing to do. He was willing to let go of everything. And he was faithful in the little things. And what we see with Daniel is that he recognized that God loves all people, but he doesn't love all ideas. And that ideas lead to behavior. And so what we do is we reach out with compassion to people while resisting the ideas that stand against what's best for them and God's best for them.
So we talk about reaching out with compassion and resisting with courage. We reach out with compassion to the individual and resist with courage the ideas that would ever take hold of this individual. And another thing that Daniel did is Daniel was a man who had a hard head and a soft heart. He had a hard head toward the principles of God, but he had a soft heart toward the people. And that's the way that we have to engage. We have to strike that balance by speaking the truth in love. And when we do that, you watch Daniel in his life, as we write about in multiple chapters of the book, he drove a stake of testimony deep into the heart of Babylon by the power of the Holy Spirit, and we can do the same.
Okay, when we come back, we're going to talk about a new term, sexual atheism. This is where people follow the Bible, except in reference to sex. It must change. To Jennifer Clark here, and everything I read, everyone that's talking about sins such as homosexuality says, I'm born that way. I can't change. What does the latest scientific evidence tell us?
Well, so much has been revealed in the last 10 years as far as the neuroscience, the plasticity of the brain, it's absolutely phenomenal. As it turns out, that all human sexuality is learned. Now, we know that in the animal kingdom, that animals have instinct and they act according to the way they were designed to procreate and have animal babies and so forth. However, humans are not so. We are not born with instinct when it comes to sex. That our brain learns. Our brain is plastic for our entire life. We can learn, we can unlearn, we can have preferences, we can change our preferences. It is absolutely phenomenal. And the scientists have learned, let's take something like obsessive compulsive disorder. Mm-hmm. Now, this is just one example of what's being done with neuroscience today. But I want to tell you, because of this plasticity of the brain, people who've had strokes can have their brains retrained, people with learning disabilities, people who have Parkinson's. It is miraculous as something can get apart from God. But as far as human sexuality, people, I forgot where I was going, Sid.
What we're talking about, for instance, homosexuals.
Right.
Are they born homosexual?
No, it's impossible. No sexuality for a human being is inborn. So what happens is what people experience in life program their brains. Now, I mentioned the OCD. So just like what happens with an addict or sexual learning, your brain forms neural pathways. There's a law called Hebb's Law, and that neurons that fire together in the brain form connections, and that way you get behavioral patterns. Now, scientists have discovered that in brain scans, that something happens with obsessive compulsive disorder, that the brain activity goes around in a cycle. Now, what this should be normally, that if we have a behavior, we have a troubling thought, we're going down this way, a troubling thought hits us, it's like driving down a road and going around a rotary. And so we say, no, that's just crazy. I don't really believe that's going to happen. And so we drive around the rotary and we go back the direction we were heading. For OCD, it's like they get in the rotary and they can't get out. So what the therapist, based on neuroscience, will do with OCD, now they can see the pattern in the brain on brain scans, they have them, okay, what we want you to do is take an emotional step back. This is just a neural pathway. No, this is not that I'm afraid of germs. This is just my OCD kicking in again. And so by taking that emotional step back, they begin to not act on the thought, and the brain map begins to weaken, and they can come out of that pattern. This is exactly the same way through the brain plasticity that anyone can break one of these brain traps, whether it's homosexuality, whether it's an addictive behavior like addiction to eating, addiction to gambling, and so forth. These can all be broken.
I was fascinated. I heard your teaching, and mm-hmm. there are things you teach that I don't think hardly anyone has heard before. Their science now is finding out that they can remap the brain with pain, where there's pain, and make the pain disappear.
Absolutely. There is a psychiatrist from Canada who published his first book back in 2006, and it has become a bestseller on brain plasticity. He has a new book that's just out on more medical wonders that are occurring, that, for example, Dr. Michael Moskowitz. He was a scientist. He understood plasticity of the brain. He was in a horrific accident, and he got trapped in the cycle of chronic pain. Now, what happens in chronic pain, areas of the brain come into agreement with the pain. So it spreads out, increases its map, the size of the brain that's affected. And so when a person gets in pain, they focus on that pain. And because what fires together, the connections expand. So 13 years, he was in such terrible pain that he almost couldn't practice medicine anymore. So he decided, well, okay, I know the areas of the brain that are affected. Now, Your brain can only focus per area on one thing at a time. I'm talking about intense focus. So he said, okay, my brain cannot focus on pain and intensely visualizing something at the same time, picturing something. And so whenever the brain would hit, he would picture something positive. And within 6 weeks, he had remapped his brain and the pain was gone. But this is for Parkinson's, this is for stroke people, cerebral palsy children. There's a place in the country that would treat cerebral palsy children. They had one little boy who in a short period of time got out of the wheelchair and was up playing baseball with other children.
Now, do you think that's something? Who gave the scientists the ability to understand what God had already created? But when you learn what science proves, and then you see the words of Jesus, everything speeds up. What experience are you finding when you and your husband pray for people? And I mean, does it take years, months?
No, it does not have to take years. If the neuroscientists are having results like that, how much more in God should we expect miracles to occur?
I mean, I'm not letting any neuroscientists do better than me, and they can't because it's God that does it. But tell me one person that you and your husband have prayed for. And what's super, see, we can talk about natural, but what supernaturally happened to them?
Well, we've had supernatural deliverances from various addictions and also from homosexuality.
Describe someone homosexual or lesbian that you might have had success with.
Okay. Now, when somebody gets in a relationship, we know somebody who was seduced, who was heterosexual, mm-hmm. and was seduced into a lesbian relationship. Now, what happens, there are spiritual forces that are taking place there. Any sexual sin, there are automatically sexual demons that get involved. So you have that going on too. But if the person wants to change and we invite God to cleanse them of those demons and to go into those neural pathways, they can get clarity of thought and they can separate themselves just like the patient with OCD. Separate that, no, that's not who God says I am. This is just that pattern clicking in, and they can walk it out to freedom.
In a few minutes, if I ask you to, can you teach us how to do this ourselves?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Do you know what? That actually frustrates me, that I want everybody to know this.
All right, you have a degree in psychology, or a PhD in theology, but when you see what tools are available to us in the supernatural, how does that compare to all the stuff you learned in psychology? Tell me the truth.
Well, I'm more excited about biology than psychology because God made me get my degree in psychology, and I saw that all psychology does is teach people how to cope with willpower. And I want for believers to live by God's power. And you know what? The kingdom of God is within. We have the miracle worker within. We have the healer within. We have all the resources, all the riches of the kingdom of God, the treasures of the kingdom of God in us. And I believe that most believers are living so far below their spiritual potential that it makes me want to cry, but that's about to change.
You and your husband, we were out to dinner one night, and you used a term that I had never heard before, but I'm going to start using it a lot. The term is called sexual atheist. Define that.
Right. Sexual atheism. Now, there are so many believers, and I don't know the numbers, but I expect that it would astound us as being way up there. Maybe even I would estimate like 70% at least of our young people. They believe the Bible, they're born again, they go to church, they generally live pretty good moral lives, except in the area of sexuality.
How can they divorce one part of the Bible from the other?
They have accepted what the culture says more than what the Bible says, but they also don't know the neuroscience of love and lust and what is actually taking place in them, nor do they understand the spiritual implications of what they are doing.
What is the difference between love and lust?
Okay, let's understand how we experience emotions. We experience emotions based on tiny molecules that are read by the receptors of our cells. Now, the molecule of love is the molecule of oxytocin. This is the molecule of bonding, attachment. This is the molecule that affects our entire body, affects our brain when a baby is born and they're with their mother. There's the baby, there's the mother, there is a flow of oxytocin. The scientists call it a limbic loop or an emotional loop as a real entity that's going on that's connecting two hearts, two lives with one another. This is, by the way, and it's experienced at several different times in somebody's life, when a baby is born, when a man and woman fall in love, and I'm talking about pure and holy love, because God is a holy God, so His love is holy. If it is not in God's will, if it is not according to God's commandments, then you've automatically moved over to lust and demonic sexual specialists. So the other time that massive amounts of oxytocin are released, and oxytocin is a neuromodulator. That means when a massive amount is released, it changes the brain, and relational pathways are written in a brain, and we can grow closer and closer in our relationships, and those pathways can become stronger and stronger. However, in a relationship that is out from under the biblical standards of God, the molecule of lust takes over. It attracts seducing spirits. Every act of sexual sin welcomes, invites, causes the attachment of seducing spirits.
Okay, let me ask you a question. It seems as though the institution of marriage is under attack. Not seems,
right.
It is under
right.
attack. And young people are living together because everyone else is doing it.
Right.
And that's got to do with that sexual atheism.
The sexual atheism.
Mm-hmm. What, according to the Bible, is happening to these couples that live together outside of marriage? What's happening to them spiritually?
Okay, well, in 1 Corinthians, it tells us that every sin man commits is apart from the body. But with sexual immorality, it's actually coming against our own body. Now, in the time that Paul was writing this, what was taking place in the pagan temples was that they would commit sexual acts in the temples, and it would invite the demons involved in that idol worship into their physical bodies. Well, when people commit sexual sin with other people, they are welcoming the demonic activity, and we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. They are welcoming the demonic activity influenced in the other person into their own body.
You know what I was thinking, and tell me this as a theologian and as understanding, as a scientist, when someone has sex with another outside of God's form of
right.
marriage, not man and man and woman and woman, but
right.
God's form of marriage.
Right.
They are taking in what I heard you say and what the Bible says, every demon of their partner, but if they're married under a union of God, that type of thing doesn't go on. So let's suppose someone's sleeping around. They take in every demon of the first person, every demon that second person had. They had enough demons to begin with. Do you see how this is multiplying?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, without God, there is no help. But guess what? With God, all things are possible. And I heard you say that you believe every time there's sexual union outside of biblical marriage, and what is biblical marriage?
Okay, the Bible in Genesis, it says God himself instituted the covenant of marriage, one man, one woman who would become one flesh, because we're human beings. We have spirits, unlike animals, and our spirit joins with our mate, the person, our spouse in marriage. Jesus in the book of Mark said exactly the same thing about marriage, that it's one man, one woman in holy matrimony who become one flesh. Now sexual sin is so bad, it invites so much demonic activity. Because of this, we have spirits. Human beings are not like animals. Humans have the distinct privilege of having spirits that can come back to God and know God. Human sex is so powerful because then a man and woman come together, have a child also with a human spirit who can come to know God. There were no restrictions on animals, just on human beings. That's because we have a power in us to create another human life created in the image of God. So God gave us sex to be a blessing, and he gave us, the Bible was not to spoil our fun, it was to tell us how to be safe to enjoy this blessing that God has given us.
What would you say to college student that hears you talking and say, and this college student puts their finger like this and says, your Bible says, do not judge?
Well, in the verse that they're quoting there, Matthew 7:1, it does say, Jesus does say, do not judge lest you be judged. However, to interpret the Bible properly, we have to understand it in context. So what does Jesus say next, right following these verses? He says, first remove the speck from your eye so you can see clearly to take the speck out of another person's eye. So he was saying, there's a speck there. There's something wrong there. You need to see clearly, not judge, but see clearly to help the other person. And then it goes down in verses 7:24, and Jesus says, judge righteous judgment. So here Jesus is telling us, judge not, but then a few verses later he's saying, judge righteous judgment. So what's the difference here? The problem is there are two meanings of the word judge. The first is to condemn someone.
Oh, that's
the second is to appraise or discern accurately.
That makes a big difference.
Right. So we are to, as Christians, we are also told in judge righteous judgment that we are supposed to judge according to spiritual judgment. We're supposed to see through the eyes of God, where our heart is supposed to be the heart of God. So we don't hate people, we don't condemn people, but we also don't water down the truth. Because why? In Ezekiel, it says, watchman, if you don't speak up and leave a person in their sin and don't tell them the truth, their blood will be on your hands. So we have a mandate from God, from Jesus himself, to judge righteous judgment. And by the way, it is not judging to tell the truth.
Okay, I agree. You have a young child, let's imagine. Mm-hmm. This young child, 7, 8 years old, comes home and says, Mommy, and with all seriousness now, at school they told me I can choose whether I'm a boy or a girl. Am I a boy or a girl, Mommy? What would you say?
Well, the first thing is that's very funny, because I had two mothers from different parts of the country ask me that question last week, because their child did come home and say that. So it means that there is an agenda to get this out into the schools. One thing, let's start with the gender issue, that God created us male or female. It says in the book of Genesis, for one thing. So God gives each person an identity, male or female. Now, this is so amazing. I have to pull out some studies for you. I've got two studies that were done recently on how gender is determined. And I have one, this must be about, this has got to be 100 or more studies on this identical issue. The science is so incontrovertible that sex is determined in the womb. Now, this is true for animals, for mammals, as well as human beings. We have either XX or XY chromosomes. If we're XX, we will become a female. Now, if we're XY, then we will become male. In the environment in the womb, around 9 weeks of age, after conception, the genetic information plus, for males, testosterone begin to kick in. And what happens is the male brain is changed. The female's the default setting, so it's the testosterone that begins to change the brain. And I have an article somewhere here on the parts of the brain that are changed by the male hormones. The collections of cells that constitute nuclei or subnuclei differ in size based on whether the testosterone is present or not. The branching pattern of the dendrites in the brain.
Okay, so science absolutely proves that it's a settled thing by God.
It's a settled thing, and it happens in the womb. It cannot change later.
Okay, now you're talking to your little child, though. You're not going to talk about testosterone and things like that.
Right.
What are you going to tell them? They come to you. What would you say? Am I a boy or a girl?
I'm going to say you are what you were born as.
Is that important for them to hear their mother or father say that?
It absolutely is. For one thing, if their parents don't say that, it's going to set up all kinds of confusion. And we know from the Bible that confusion is not from God. And that God loved them, He chose them to be a male or female right from the very beginning. And it's impossible to change. As a matter of fact, the science is so clear on this that it's actual insanity. And I would like to share, do I have a moment to share a study with you?
Sure.
Okay, back at Johns Hopkins University in the 1970s, there was a group pushing the ability to change gender, and they actually did sex change surgery on some men, and lo and behold, they found out these men that were physically different, but they weren't more well-adjusted. They were just as troubled. They had the same problems that they had beforehand, and so they stopped doing it, and they said it's a mental disorder, and it's like an anorexic, right? A person who thinks they're fat when they're actually malnourished and wasting away, they're so thin. This one particular psychiatrist who was the head of Johns Hopkins psychiatry department said that going along with this sex change surgery and trying to change genders because somebody had a gender dysphoria, an anorexic has a dysmorphia, an unreal perception in their body, they said both are mental disorders, and you wouldn't give an anorexic liposuction because they feel they're fat, and so you shouldn't give somebody surgery because they have a delusion, by the way, which is a type of psychosis, a delusion that they are something different from the way they were born.
So if this is true, if this is science, why are insurance companies paying for sex change operations? I wouldn't pay if I was an insurance company and had that science.
Right. Well, the science is so clear about gender, and the science is so clear about human sexuality being learned, that I have to feel like a deliberate fraud is being perpetrated through all these entities working together. And I believe it's directed ultimately against God to tear down His established order, the way that society can be stable.
Okay. I want you to, because you say, if you're a little child, you can learn this. Briefly, I want you to look in the camera and I want you to teach us how to get rid of these lies we have inside of us.
Okay, I want to take you first through?
Look at the camera.
Cleansing from sexual sin. Should we start there? Where do you want us to start?
Just in general. I want you to teach in general.
Okay, in general. In general, what we do to get set free, we have to go to the kingdom of God within, to Messiah within. And what we do, if we have believed a lie, and by the way, all homosexuals have at some point, we call it the entry point, the time when something got started, have believed a lie, I am different. Why not? Well, if you like chocolate ice cream and I liked vanilla, we would have different preferences. I wouldn't say I'm different. Why the lie, I am different? Because it's against God's created order. Therefore, we want to go in prayer. We want to bring this into the presence of God in prayer. We go, God, I have this issue. Close our eyes and pray. We want to go down to our spirit. Jesus said, out of your belly flows rivers of living water. So you think of the issue in prayer and feel the feeling down in your gut.
Now, most people think their spirit is their heart, but according to Jesus, the spirit is in the gut.
According to Jesus, according to the Old Testament, according to the New Testament, the bowels of compassion used in both the Old and New Testament. I've done whole word studies on this. But this is the location of the door of the heart. So in prayer, you open, you let yourself feel anything negative attached. And then you let Jesus, the Messiah, the forgiver in you, release a river of forgiveness out to other people. Receive forgiveness for believing a lie. And you can be doing this while I'm talking. Just like when you got saved, you received forgiveness as a gift. You yield and receive forgiveness. Now, no talking is necessary in any of this, but if you have believed a lie, if you hear a lie like, I am different, renounce that lie out loud, then go.
In other words, let me get this straight. You kind of drop down to mm-hmm. where your spirit
right,
is.
Right.
And then you say, Holy Spirit, what lie have I believed? And you'll hear something.
Right.
And then you renounce it. And I understand forgiveness is a big part of that.
Yes. Before you have power to renounce it, you have to receive forgiveness until you get peace. Jesus gave you peace as a gift. It's always available. And then get back in prayer. Go back down to your spirit and say, Lord, what's the truth? What do you say? And the Lord will speak something to you. He'll quicken the truth to your heart, and then you can receive it, and the lie will be displaced.
You know, there's so many things that we deal with. But if science now is contradicting our legislators, and that's what you're telling me.
Exactly.
I mean, you know what I want to pray? I want to pray God will raise up godly politicians. And let me give you my definition of a godly politician. One that is against murder of babies in the womb. One that is for the biblical institution of marriage. That's a godly politician. I want to pray that God will raise up godly politicians, because there is going to be such a move of God's Spirit. But let it begin now. Let it even begin now in your country or in the United States of America. I pray in the name that is above every name and the blood that defeated Satan, I pray in Jesus' name that the politicians that are running, God will raise up the godly. He even knows their heart. He even knows the ones that will turn to him in office. And I pray that we know who are the ones that will turn to him in office. And I pray that there are people right now that God's calling you to run in politics. Don't just do it. Do it because if it's a call from God. And I pray that our whole Congress and Senate and Supreme Court and presidency and state legislatures will put prayer first, and it won't be a cosmetic, now I lay me down to sleep. No, no. It's going to be a mighty God. I pray there be such a move of God's Spirit, you agree with me, in our Senate, in our Congress, in our White House, that those in charge will be on their face before Almighty God and say, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. And I pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
The Benham Brothers were real estate tycoons that were offered their own reality TV program on HGTV. But because they stood on their moral convictions concerning what is holy and what is sin, HGTV canceled their contract. God rewarded the Benham Brothers for their faithfulness by giving them a bigger platform than they would have had with their own TV program. They continue to appear on the most watched secular news programs. They're speaking in large venues across America, sharing the gospel and continuing to promote biblical morality. Now they want to share how you can obtain supernatural courage to be a world changer. Call now and get David and Jason Benham's Daniel Anointing Package, which includes their book, Living Among Lions, How to Thrive Like Daniel in Today's Babylon, and their three-part audio CD teaching, How to Be a World Changer, plus Dr. Jen Clark's audio CD, Answering Questions in a Modern-Day Babylon. Yours for a donation of $35. Shipping and handling is included. Ask for offer number 9406. In the Benham Brothers' powerful must-read book, Living Among Lions, they passionately share their own story of taking a stand for righteousness, even though it appeared to rob them of great notoriety and prosperity through having their own TV reality program on HGTV. But what the enemy meant to harm, God used to prosper them. In the book, they draw upon the Jewish Old Testament prophet Daniel.
Daniel stood up for God against certain persecution. The Benham Brothers stood up for God against certain persecution. Guess what? Daniel was elevated to number two in the kingdom. Guess what? The Benham Brothers are a household word and doing just fine. If God is for you, who can be against you? The same thing that happened to Daniel, the same thing that happened to the Benham Brothers is going to happen for you if you'll put God first. What are you going to do?
You'll also receive the Benham Brothers' exclusive three-part audio CD teaching series, How to Be a World Changer.
On these three CDs, there is an impartation of supernatural courage, special prayers at the end, but even as they share, this courage is going to go right out of the CD into you. It's called the Daniel Anointing. And we are in a time that either Christians will have courage, or this is what's going to happen. We're going to lose our country. We're going to lose our children. We're going to lose our families. We're going to flat lose everything. Well, I have faith that God is going to change America. There's going to be a great move of God's Spirit, but God is looking for people with a Daniel anointing. What are you going to tell your children when they come in from elementary school and say, Mom, Dad, am I a male or a female? Am I a boy or a girl? You've got to decide which you're going to do. Are you going to have good answers for good questions? Or are you going to be just roll over and play dead? I mean, you choose.
You will also receive Dr. Jen Clark's exclusive audio CD, Answering Questions in a Modern Day Babylon.
I'm so excited about Dr. Jen Clark because she put together the latest findings in science. This is a woman that has a PhD, Dr. Clark. She has degrees in psychology and in theology, and she's a specialist in the brain. Latest science says what the Bible says. Now, I have faith for all the sexual deviancy that is being taught as normal to turn around. But you can't roll over and play dead. Now you choose. What do you want for your family? What do you want for your country? Some of the things that Dr. Jen Clark said, I've never even pondered. Like for instance, she talks about the difference between love and lust, marriage biblically, living together without being married? Does morality change because the times have changed? And these are things that honest people are going to be asking you.
With all the pressure by the unbelieving world to be silent, to be politically correct, you need this one-of-a-kind Daniel anointing package for such a time as this.
You need the answers. I can't impress upon you more with what is going on in society and how quickly it's lowering the bar. Someone, somewhere has to stand up. Say, that's me, Sid. I want to stand up. I want the Daniel anointing.
Don't miss out on getting David and Jason Benham's Daniel Anointing Package, which includes their book, Living Among the Lions, How to Thrive Like Daniel in Today's Babylon, plus their three-part audio CD teaching, How to Be a World Changer, plus Dr. Jen Clark's audio CD, Answering Questions in a Modern Day Babylon. Yours for a donation of $35. Shipping and handling is included. Ask for offer number 9406. Call or you can send your check to Sid Roth. It's Supernatural, P.O. Box 39222, Charlotte, North Carolina. Carolina 28278. Please specify offer number 9406 or log on to sidroth.org. Call or write today.